Hey, I'm Travis Konecny, and you're listening to Snow the Goalie.
And now we'd like to welcome into Snow the Goalie, very special guest, Russ, Philadelphia Flyers all-star, Travis Konecny. Travis, thanks for joining us here on Snow the Goalie.
Yeah, thanks for having me.
How does that feel, by the way? Have you gotten used to it yet?
It hasn't really settled in yet, no, but I'm sure it will once the break starts here, and it's kind of my next stop. I think I'll start getting the nerves for it and excitement.
Are you going to take part in any of the pre-game festivities, like the fastest skater or shot?
I believe so.
Yeah.
I think it's up to the team captain, so we'll have to see what they put me in. But I'm kind of nervous for that too, because that can either be a good thing or a bad thing depending on what you're going in.
Well, this is going to come out before the All-Star game, so if you want to make a public plea right now, if you could pick a part of the skills contest to be in. Is there one that you have your eye on?
Preferably nothing with a puck. So just the
skate,
fastest
right?
Lap.
Skate,
yeah,
right?
that would be one that I'd be interested in. Yeah.
Well, let's talk about the season, because in a lot of ways, you had really two really nice seasons the last 2 years, but in a lot of ways, this is your quote unquote breakout, right? For so far, how have you felt? I mean, how's it been for you? And obviously, your confidence level has to be sky high right now.
Yeah, it's been it's definitely been a season that I didn't expect. I was just coming in trying to better myself, two-way game, like focus on the things that I hadn't been able to focus on previously. And I definitely feel more confident with the puck, and it helps. The guys I'm playing with too are they make it easy sometimes when they put the puck on your stick. You don't expect it, so. All around, I've been pretty happy, with the season.
And what's it like playing? I mean, you guys have not just AV, but you have three, basically, former NHL head coaches.
Yeah.
Now one is the head coach, two assistants. What's it like playing for those guys and them having such, holding you guys, really accountable for the way you play night in, night out?
Yeah, I think it's an interesting setup, and I think a lot of people were unsure how it was going to work with three, possibly head coaches, and. In my opinion, they've done a great job. The two assistants, for sure, have, in my opinion, done a tremendous job being more personal and, talking with the players, getting to know them on a different level. And AV's done that too, and did his own homework on everybody. But I think they've done a great job. And when they have to step up and hold you accountable, French Michael will come down the bench, and me and Beezer both wear that. you gotta be on your toes, but at the same time, he knows how to let that head coach side of him go and relate to the players.
AB talked a lot when he sat down with us before the season about not wanting to go back and watch any film on anybody from the previous season. I don't totally believe him, but that's what he said. From your perspective, having a new coach come in and knowing the kind of clout that he brings, the kind of legitimacy he brings as a coach, not to say that the previous coaches weren't, but mm-hmm. this is a different level. How important was it for you to get off to a quick start? I mean, I know guys say that every year you want to go off to a good start, but especially for this coach.
Yeah. It was important to me. And I mean, he made it clear to me though, that he wasn't going to look into the past. And we sat down and had a conversation, and he showed me a blank sheet of paper and said, "This is what I know about you right now, and it's up to you to fill it in." And, I took that pretty, seriously, that it was my chance to, prove to a coach that I can play in every situation. And, it's been good so far. I mean, it's the first time in a while that I've played when we're up one goal and I've played like the last 6 minutes of a game. So it's a little different for me being out there.
Do you ever go back and this question's coming out of nowhere, but do you ever go back and watch like a TV replay of yourself, especially after you get knocked to the ice, or you always seem to like have this look on your face like, what just happened?
Yeah.
And do people give you any hard time about that or anything?
No,
like that?
I mean, other than my mom saying get off the ice, I don't really hear about it, but I know exactly what you're talking about,
right?
Well, I fall too much too, so like I probably have it on my face the whole game.
I almost think you got like a future in acting a lot of times.
I
see that.
I might, I don't know, I hope not.
Well, the funny thing is, like, the more people that follow us and the more we kind of get back with the listeners and such, the more we start to find that there are a lot of young women who follow this team who will take clips of you getting off the ice with the hair over the face and flipping your hair back. And I'm not trying to embarrass you or anything, but I don't know, how does it feel to be somebody that a lot of the ladies in the fan base are
looking at? I don't know. Yeah, that should be Young Beezer taking over that. Yeah, it's pretty funny. I mean, it's just something to laugh about, you know. You try to be nice to the fans, but there's been some funny ones. I remember the first time I actually was having my girlfriend come visit me, and we were kind of new and fresh, and we were leaving the rink, and I pulled over to sign some autographs, and some girls started crying in my window of my car, and my girlfriend is like looking at me like, what's going on? And I was like, I don't know. But yeah, it's pretty funny that you mentioned that though. But.
Well, you're like a meme too. Like you're they meme you all the time.
Oh, man.
Do they?
Yeah. Oh my god.
I clipped the other day. I think it was the pass from JVR. And you said, what an effing pass. And then somebody came over to you. I forget who it was. They came right up next to you. And you're like, what a pass, huh?
Yeah, like and, you repeated it like a second time.
And this thing went nuts. Like, people went crazy about
really?
It.
Really?
Oh, yeah.
Yeah. It's funny because, like, I have to give you credit on this one. A lot of times, a guy gets that first all-star selection. And fans kind of worry that it's going to go to a guy's head. And in recent days, I think you did a signing yesterday.
Yep.
I think you might have done one again recently or earlier in the season.
Okay.
And I don't know if Anthony has, but I do at least get DMs from fans who say it's really great to see a young guy who's had a lot of success in the league still be engageable.
Yeah.
And relatable in a sense. And that hasn't always been the case. And especially here, that hasn't always been the case.
Yeah.
So how do you not let stuff get to your head?
I don't know. I mean, I think for me, I know I have a great opportunity to go to the All-Star game this year. And I'm proud of being able to go there and thankful for everyone that's helped me get there and whatnot. But you know, at the same time, I look at it like, you know, Connor McDavid's going to the All-Star game and he's got almost like 80 points already. So I know, like, you know, I'm at 40 points, which is, you know, I'm happy. It's a great stepping stone. But, I mean, I know that, you know, I still have to be humble. There's a lot of great guys and great skill and great players that are out there that I still, you know, I have a lot of work and a lot of time and effort to put in still to, you know, even be able to be mentioned in some of these name
categories. It's going to be interesting. So. I mean, you're suddenly going to be teammates for a day or 2 days with some guys you have like a real bitter rivalry with.
I know.
What are you preparing for that?
Like, do you keep it up, by the way? Like, let's keep going with that.
Yeah. I don't know.
Do you keep the hatred there?
I mean, it's
funny. You can't break kayfabe. Like, this is like a pro wrestling thing. Like, you can't possibly, like, go up to somebody and say, like, hey, you know what? I actually respect your game. You can't do that.
Well, I know. I mean, I think it's going to – I hope at the All-Star game I can, you know, get the opportunity to meet some of the guys so they, you know me a little off the ice because I have a reputation on the ice to, you know, run my mouth a lot and get under people's skin. But I don't know. We'll see how it goes. I mean, we've joked a couple times after I got cross-checked by Perron in St. Louis that if we played them in the All-Star game, maybe I hit him or something. Get back at him. But, I mean, I'd never do that. But
Since you brought up chirping, I have to ask because it's maybe the most quotable thing you've ever said. Going after Malkin.
Oh,
in the Stadium Series game and calling him an effing nerd.
Yeah, I know.
Where the hell did that come from?
I don't know. I mean, I feel like a lot of times I'll hear a chirp and I'll repeat it, whether it came from Patty or Lawton or something, and they didn't say it loud enough, so I'll make sure that somebody hears it. I don't know if that was the case. Yeah, but it's kind of funny how that stuck around because I was actually just with my family the other day getting a cheesesteak. It was my first time. I was down at Pat's and Gino's there, and some guys, like, I'm just getting my cheesesteak and drives by, he's yelling, "Eat up, bud," and I was like, "What?" And I clued in that he was talking about the video, and it was like kind of random, but yeah, it stuck around for a while.
Yeah.
Who's a low-key chirper on the bench that doesn't get credit for being a guy that we maybe think about as being a trash talker?
I mean, I don't know if you guys know about Lawton, but he's constantly.
Oh, yeah?
Like, constantly.
I know he's intense.
He's intense. Like, he's very engaged in the game, but Yeah, if you were to ever just put a camera on him and his lips during a game, he's constantly giving it to guys. Constantly.
That's fantastic. Oh, yeah. That's great to know.
What's a guy like Hazy like? Because now I think people are starting to get a feel for him because of like the mic'd up kind of segments. But yeah. Is he like that all the time? Or do you think he kind of ramps it up just for the mic?
No, he's like that. He's probably worse off the mic. He's probably toned down on the mic.
Really?
Oh, yeah. He's constant energy, outgoing. Oh, yeah. You need to be, a good 10 hours sleep and a coffee before you talk to Hazy because he's he's ready to go. It's the moment he walks in the door.
How does he fit in on this team? Because I know that like in the off season when he got the A, a lot of people were questioning because he's new to the locker room, and it's not the most normal thing to have that kind of thing happen. I think G said after a game a few weeks ago that it feels like, or Hazy said he feels like he's been on this team for years. Does it kind of feel like that from your perspective?
Yeah,
as well?
It does. I mean, from the moment we went over to Prague, he was. It did feel like he had been with us for a long time, and I mean, and my getting to know him was shorter than everyone else's too, because he was down here before camp and getting to know guys and golfing with guys and stuff, and I never had that chance to do that with him. And from the moment I met him, it seemed like I had known him for a while, and we were rekindling and getting to catch up. So it's kind of cool how we can change the locker room like that.
Now, I know you wanted to bring this up, Russ. So I'm going
to
let you do it because this is your thing, the whole scrum lurker nonsense.
Okay.
Do you know scrum lurkers?
No.
Do you ever watch TSN, Jay and Dan?
Yeah, I mean, more or less back home.
Okay.
So they
have a bit that they do where it's all quick little snapshots of media scrums in the locker room.
Okay.
And on these scrums, what they do, instead of focusing on the player, they will find some goofy media guy hiding behind you trying to get a video.
Okay.
All right. So the most recent edition of Scrum Lurkers.
And I've got to apologize to you in advance. I'm pulling it up right now, but
not only are you in it.
Well, the only reason he wants to bring it up is
they're focusing on me.
Qualities.
Stand behind
right
you.
Here.
And
right.
It's really kind of pathetic.
I'm going to show this to you. So I just. All right. So there you are. And there's Anthony.
Yeah.
And that's the video right there. They're going on here. And we'll just do that little. There it is. That's the money shot right there.
Right? All right, it's so ridiculous.
So, first of all,
that's pretty funny.
When we're set up around everybody, you've got a couple inches on me, but in fairness, like I can't reach over everybody else. Like Bill Melcher, we love, is ginormous, right? So I'm usually behind everybody because it's the path of least resistance. How aware are you? Let me ask you, I guess that first. How aware are you of being circled around versus having everybody in front of you?
Yeah, it doesn't feel like that, honestly. Like it feels like the mics that are here. It's kind of who you're talking to be honest. But it is funny because sometimes like a question will come from like left field and you're like,
who's that?
Like, whoa, who's this guy? And he's like, someone standing right behind you with a mic. Yeah, but it is pretty funny.
Well, see, my philosophy is this. And maybe you can tell me if I'm right or wrong. So my philosophy is, I don't like scrums, as a media guy, I don't like scrums because I don't feel like you guys are really going to say anything that's of great value.
Yeah.
Maybe Jake every once in a while.
Yeah, he
has no filter, right?
Yeah.
But other than that, I mean, really, you guys are just going to give this the pretty much basic answer.
Yeah.
So my philosophy is, if I get in the back as it's ending, if there's something that I feel that I want to ask, I could say, hey, Travis, you got an extra minute or two? And pull you off to the side. And then if we're talking one-on-one, you're more likely to give me a more in-depth response because the cameras aren't on you guys. You feel a little bit more comfortable in a one-on-one conversation than 30 people. Am I correct?
Yeah, that's right. I agree.
So there you go. So that's why we end up on Scrum Lurkers.
So then you don't have any reason to be like over the guy's shoulder. I mean, I was going to ask him like what cologne you were wearing because, like, I mean, good God,
it's after a game.
I mean,
anyway,
that's a lot. All right. So one question that we like to ask on the show is there anything, and especially with the West Coast swing, I've got to imagine that there aren't that many things to entertain yourself with. Is there anything that you stream? Is there any show or movies that you've seen recently that captured your attention?
I mean, I don't know. Me and, I don't know if everyone's into this stuff, but me and my girl are, like, really into, like, documentaries about like murder cases in the past.
I watch them all.
And it's like, I feel like guilty watching them sometimes because I'm like, I don't want to like have an interest in this stuff, but like, I find it.
You're not alone.
It's fascinating. Okay.
Yeah, it's crazy. I've watched so many, and there's been, I heard Beezer talking about the...
Don't F with Cats.
Well, that one was crazy. I actually was watching that in my hotel room in Carolina after we finished our long road swing there. And I got up and I put the latch on the hotel door thinking like, I don't know anybody here who has a key. Like it could be anybody.
Well, I probably had to bother you even a little more because it's close to home, right? It was up in Toronto, right?
Yeah. So watching all this stuff's, it's just crazy to me. And there's other shows that I'm into as well. Like I'm into Power. I don't know if you guys have seen Power.
No.
It's a great TV series. A lot of the guys on the team are into it too.
What's that on? What's that streaming on?
That's Stars.
It might be.
Yeah, it might be Stars.
It's a great show. But I mean, if there's a new murder documentary or some sort of
Did you watch the HBO special? It was like based on the Serial podcast, the Adnan Syed.
Oh yeah, I saw that one.
I don't know if I saw that. Wait, is it on Netflix or is it on?
No, it was on HBO.
HBO Go.
And it was based on the first season of the Serial podcast. Okay. It was really good.
Yeah, it was good. So I'm sure you've seen like Making a Murderer.
Yeah.
Yeah, good stuff. Did you see The Staircase?
Is that the lady that fell down
the steps?
Yeah, I saw that one.
Wow,
yeah.
How happened?
Right? Seriously, I mean, I've watched them all.
Like Ted Bundy, seen that.
Yeah, that's a good one. Did you watch the Aaron Hernandez one yet?
Yeah, I watched that one. There was another good one I watched yesterday. It was called The Confession Killer.
Oh, yeah, The Confession Killer, yeah.
And I didn't
There's a second season coming out of that.
Yeah, but... Yeah, the guy's kind of all over the place, so I'm trying to figure it out.
I'll give you one more that's a couple years old now, but it's still on Netflix, called The Keepers.
The Keepers?
The Keepers, and it's about the murder of a nun in Baltimore in the 60s, and then how they investigate it 40 years later.
Okay.
And it's really, really intense. It's good. Yeah, it's a good one. That's a good
one.
Interesting. All right, from morbid stuff, is there anything else that you watch that's... There's some parent who's listening to this show.
Oh yeah,
you're not allowed to be. Travis Konecny
was a really nice guy, but he's got a real dark sense of humor. Like, is there
just ruined it for everybody? Yeah. I think. If I'm going with something a little softer, like I've watched like This Is Us.
Oh yeah.
I mean, I watch that from time to time. Other than that, I don't get into shows that much. I watch the typical like Stranger Things.
Yeah.
Those I've kind of watched all those.
Yeah. We got to ask about a movie because we've asked every player that's been on the show, and Russ is over. He's over because I've been right on every one.
Okay.
If you were stuck on an island and you can only have one hockey movie for the rest of your life to watch, which one are you watching?
A hockey movie.
And it could also be that it's just a movie that you enjoy watching that's very quotable.
Stop it.
So it has to be like a hockey movie.
Hockey movie.
Yeah.
I don't know. Maybe MVP.
Wow.
That's the first time anybody's ever answered that.
Either one of us.
Wow.
Actually, that's not true. Miracle. JBR said Miracle.
Yeah.
Which was a good one. But, I say Slapshot.
Okay, yeah.
And Russ says
I say Goon.
Goon.
Goon's a good one, too, yeah.
Yeah. Well, see, somebody said that it's good.
Okay.
Everybody else, Beezer gave him a hard time. He's like, dude, that's not real. He's like, it's not real.
That's what everybody says. I'm not saying what's the most realistic hockey movie. I'm saying
asking people who play the game for a living what their favorite is. Of course, they want something that's more realistic, right?
I mean, mine's not very realistic either. MVP's not.
Yeah, you could have gone Mystery Alaska.
Yeah, I could have done that one. That's a good one.
So, since, All-Star... ramping it up. There are a lot of people to thank, I'm sure, along the way.
Yeah.
And to that idea, have you had a favorite place that you've gotten to play that has a memory that sticks out? Because obviously this All-Star one is going to be a huge memory.
Yeah.
Is there a place, it doesn't have to be at the NHL level, that you played over the course of your career that stands out for any reason?
There's probably a number of places. But for me, I think the most memorable one is just going back to where I played most of my minor hockey, where I grew up loving the game. And, there's a couple of the rinks, but I played a lot of minor hockey in Kamoka, which is a small little town where the Elgin Middlesex Chiefs are out of. So, yeah, a lot of good memories there, grandparents, parents,
you
friends.
Were part of the craziest trade.
In the OHL?
That I've ever seen.
Yeah, it was, yeah.
Was it like 2 players and 10 draft picks for you?
Yeah, so what I think happened there was because I think I was supposed to come back the next year.
Uh-huh.
Which was originally the plan, and then I ended up making the NHL. But when they made the trade, it was because I was basically being traded for an extra season, and then I didn't come back. So,
so not only did they trade away yeah. 10 picks, yeah,
they didn't get me, and I was injured in playoffs. So. Yeah, it was tough.
That's brutal. That's brutal. That's one of the craziest trades. 10 draft picks in one trade.
It's got to make you feel special.
I mean, yeah, I didn't know. It was me and another guy on my team, so it was... It's a good trade.
So awesome. You're very close to tying. I think you're 7 points off. You're 42 right now. Career high is 49 at the NHL level from tying that 49-point mark. What can you attribute, or what would you attribute such a boost in production to?
That's funny. I just had a conversation downstairs in our media scrum, and they asked me the question, and I don't know if it's because of, now I have a contract and I'm not stressing so much about trying to produce and trying to prove myself. Obviously, I'm still trying to do the best I can do every time I get on the ice, but I can focus a little more on parts of my game that don't put me in bad situations, so the coach trusts me, and that, that leads to more opportunity. They trust you trying to tie the game up or trying to play with a lead, things like that.
Yeah.
And I think that's kind of given me more opportunity this year. And then maybe I'm just capitalizing a little more on the opportunities.
You seem more relaxed.
Yeah.
Somebody watching the game.
Yeah, like, just
the last 3
more
years.
Like poise, I think. Yeah. Instead of throwing the puck away or making poor decisions, I have a little more confidence with the puck, I think.
Yeah.
Yeah.
That's great. That's great.
Feels
well,
good.
Travis, we really appreciate you taking the time. Thanks a lot for joining us here on Snow the Goalie. Best luck to you the rest of the way, and hopefully we'll talk to you again down the road.
Yeah, thanks, guys.